In the 1930s, two monstrous evils arose on opposite sides of the world, in Japan and in Germany. In both countries, there arose totalitarian governments bent on conquest. Everywhere that they prevailed, terror and genocide soon followed. The Nazis established death camps where they murdered millions of people whom they considered undesirables. At the same time, on the other side of the world, the Japanese were massacring the Chinese, as well as Southeast Asians and Pacific Islanders. Here also, millions of innocent people would die at the hands of a truly evil regime. Japan had long desired to establish an empire. Korea was annexed in the early part of the 20th century, and the Japanese invaded Manchuria in the 1930s. They were soon invading the rest of China, and after their sneak attack on Pearl Harbor on December 7th of 1941, they went on a rampage of conquest throughout the South Pacific. The British surrendered their army at Singapore in February of 1942, and the Japanese had soon taken most of New Guinea and the surrounding island chains. They began bombing the cities of northern Australia, obviously preparing for an invasion there too. The Japanese were ruled by an emperor named Hirohito, whom they considered to be a divine being. His goal, and that of his generals, was to eliminate all Western influences in the Pacific. There would be no more Dutch East Indies, no more French Indochina, no British Singapore, no more Australian influence in New Guinea and other islands, and no more Americans in the Philippines. After that, Australia would become a target for invasion, and judging by what the Japanese army had done in China, the genocide in Australia would have been unimaginable. After all Western influences in Asia and the Pacific had been swept away, they would be replaced, according to Japanese propaganda, by something that they termed the Greater East Asian Co-Prosperity Sphere. However, as the Japanese invaded country after country, it soon became evident that the only people who were intended to prosper were the Japanese. All others would be ruled over as little better than slaves. As they pursued their plans, the Japanese feared only one source of opposition: America and its Pacific Fleet, which was based at Pearl Harbor in the Hawaiian Islands. And that is why on December 7th, 1941, without declaring war, in order to achieve complete surprise, they attacked Pearl Harbor. A Japanese fleet crept undetected within 250 miles of Pearl Harbor and launched swarms of dive bombers and torpedo planes. America was suddenly at war. And after Japan's ally, Germany, also declared war on the U.S., it was a two-front war. At Pearl Harbor, over 2,400 Americans were killed, and the U.S. Pacific Fleet was crippled. The Japanese attack proved one thing beyond all doubt. In this war, unlike in World War I, air power would be the deciding factor. American engineers went to work, designing new high-performance warplanes. Using assembly line techniques that had been developed for automobiles, American factories cranked out thousands of fighters, bombers, and cargo planes. American four-engine bombers, mainly the B-17 and the B-24, could carry tons of bombs for thousands of miles. and they struck at the enemy's factories, transportation systems, airfields, shipping and harbors, oil refineries, and other resources necessary to pursue the war. A four-engine heavy bomber required a crew of 10 men. At the height of B-24 bomber production, Ford's Willow Run plant in Michigan was turning out one bomber per hour. These thousands of bombers would require tens of thousands of trained crewmen to fly them. The young men of America answered the call.
Goodbye, Mama. I'm off to Yokohama for the red, white, and blue. My country and you.
They came from schools, farms, factories, offices, mines. They were a cross-section of American youth.
Goodbye, dear. I'll be back in a year. 'Cause I'm in the army now.
They were young men from every walk of life. Many whose only previous experience with teamwork had been on the popular city baseball teams of the day found themselves on quite a different kind of team in the Air Corps, where the stakes were not trophies, but life and death. Today, over 70 years after the war, people rummaging around among old papers in their attics, basements, or closets come across photographs of bomber crews that their fathers, grandfathers, or other relatives served on. By now, so many years after the war, many, if not most of the men in these photographs, have lived out their lives and are gone. Every one of them had a story to tell, and sadly, most of these stories will go forever untold. Wouldn't it be fascinating if we could still ask a few of these men questions about what it was like to fly a warplane in the greatest war in human history? But what chance do we have to do so today, over 7 decades after the end of World War II? Well, sometimes, even today, you can get lucky.
Get it all there. That was when I...
James H. Horner piloted B-24 bombers and flew 46 combat missions against the Japanese between May of 1944 and April of 1945. Now 95 years old and retired in Florida, he can still vividly recall those days and those missions. Another member of this crew also remembers those days and those dangerous bombing missions.
As we got over the jump target, he says, I'm going to throw...
Jaime Baca, or properly pronounced in Spanish, Jaime Baca, was one of the two waist gunners of the crew. Today, 93 years old and active as a deacon in the Catholic Church near Albuquerque, New Mexico, he too can recall his experiences in the Pacific War in vivid detail. A third member of this crew, the navigator, Tom Theobald, lives today in a small town in Iowa.
Just from the position as mess officer.
He's 95 years old, and he too is still going strong. As the navigator, it was his job to plot the course to wherever the bomber was going. He had a reputation for being one of the best. In 50 combat missions, he always managed to get the bomber to the target and then find the way home again, day or night. All the other members of this crew have passed away in the years since the war. But Mr. Horner, Mr. Baca, and Mr. Theobald have all graciously consented to relate to us some of their experiences flying a B-24 heavy bomber in combat against the Japanese in the Pacific War Theater. Bomber crews were commonly referred to by the name of their pilot. So this was the Horner crew. As with all bomber crews, each member was a specialist in his job, and each had been trained separately in a different school for the task that he was assigned. As the pilot, Lieutenant Horner from Hazel Park, Michigan, was the commander of the bomber sitting in the cockpit's left seat. Like the captain of a ship, he made all decisions concerning the flight and operation of the aircraft. The lives of the other 9 men were therefore in his hands. It was a heavy responsibility for a 22-year-old. But he wasn't the youngest bomber pilot by any means. Some of them were actually teenage. The Air Corps based its assignments on demonstrated ability, not age. After graduating from high school, James Horner was working in a defense plant, running a lathe 12 hours a day, 7 days a week. In June of 1942, on his 21st birthday, James decided, just on an impulse, to see if he could pass the Air Corps entrance exam at the Federal Building in downtown Detroit. He'd never been in an airplane in his life and had never really thought about flying one, but he passed the exam. He signed up for the Air Corps, and 6 months later, he was in uniform and in flight training, working his way through the Air Corps' primary, basic, and multi-engine trainers. But flying in these small training planes had done nothing to prepare him for his first close-up look at the huge 4-engine, 30-ton B-24 heavy bomber.
The instructor takes us out, and we walk up alongside this airplane. It's 11 feet up to the pilot's window. It's further from the pilot to the end of the wingtip on one side of the airplane than the biggest airplane we've ever been in, including the airliners. The wing's 110 feet long, and you're supposed to park this with the wingtip 6 inches apart. They're going to tell you to fly this thing up in the air when you don't even think they could get it up in the air on jacks. The plane weighs 35 tons, full of gas, ready to go. It's got 4 engines with 1,200 horsepower each. Boy. Well, at that time, I knew I was in the wrong business. I knew I should have joined the Navy.
However, despite his initial misgivings, by the time the flight training was over, few people could fly a B-24 as well as Lieutenant James Horner.
He was a highly skilled pilot and a very gutsy pilot, too, I would say. You know, I look back and I said, the skill of that man is what saved us a number of times. He was a really first-class pilot.
The co-pilot of the crew was Lieutenant Alan G. Cooper from San Francisco, California. The co-pilot of a B-24 shared the flying duties with the pilot and was ready to take over in the event that the pilot became incapacitated. The bombardier was Lieutenant Sylvester A. Ostafin from Detroit, Michigan. Since the purpose of a bomber such as the B-24 was to bomb targets, it could be said that he had the most important job in the crew. He had nothing to do until the bomber made its short run over the target, and then his skill made all the difference to the success of a mission. During the minutes of the bomb run, he took control of the bomber through his bomb sight and released the bombs at just the right instant to accurately hit the target. Lieutenant Tom Theobald from Olwine, Iowa, was the crew's navigator. Using his maps, plotting tools, mechanical flight computer, and radio fixes, he plotted the route to and from targets, or anywhere else the bomber was going, and provided the pilot with compass headings, checkpoints, and advice on steering an accurate course. Theobald, like many young men, had joined the Air Corps hoping to become a pilot.
I did not qualify for pilot training. My eyes were not good. I didn't qualify as a bombardier. The only thing left was that I could possibly be a navigator. But I can remember that officer said, well, how much college have you had? And I said, well, I've never been to college. He said, well, you probably never make it as a navigator. But that was all I needed as an incentive. I was going to make it as a navigator.
And make it he did. Not only did he make it through navigation school, he became one of the best navigators in the Air Corps. In combat missions that required over 14 hours in the air and covered thousands of miles of mostly water in both daylight and darkness, Lieutenant Theobald always got the bomber to the target and then steered his crew safely home again. The flight engineer was Sergeant Ernest L. Eady from Orange, Texas. The flight engineer was the crew's mechanic, and he knew more about the B-24 than any other crew member. In mechanical emergencies, he was the one the pilot turned to. He also operated the bomber's top gun turret. Sergeant J.W. Dale from Pleasant Hill, Missouri, was the left waist gunner. The B-24 had large square openings or windows on each side of the fuselage between the wings and the tail. In both of these waist windows, a gunner manned a single 50-caliber machine gun on a flexible mount as a defense against enemy fighter planes. At their stations, the two waist gunners worked back-to-back, or side-to-side. The radio operator was Sergeant Doy E. Bruni from Charleston, West Virginia. He sat at his radio table behind the co-pilot, and he served as the bomber's connection to the outside world. He could also sometimes assist the navigator by getting radio position fixes. Sergeant Edmund Rogalski of Illinois was the nose gunner. He operated a hydraulically powered turret on the nose of the bomber, and his job was to ward off frontal attacks by enemy fighter planes. The right waist gunner was Sergeant Jaime Baca of Albuquerque, New Mexico, and he was also the plane's armorer. As the armorer, he was the crew's expert on machine guns and bombs. When bombs were loaded aboard the B-24, they were not armed. It was the armorer's job to remove the safety pins and arm the bombs before they were dropped on the target.
The pilot would call me and says, time to pull out the safety pins. And I would go on this little catwalk, 8 inches wide. And you go in there and I'd be plucking all the safety pins out of the bombs.
Sergeant Kenneth I. Carter from Kansas, only 18 years old, was the bomber's tail gunner. He operated a power turret exactly like the one on the nose and fended off enemy fighter plane attacks from the rear. Everyone in the bomber who manned a gun had attended gunnery school. Sergeant Baca had been to the gunnery school at Laredo Army Airfield in Texas. He remembers that the course started with skeet shooting, firing shotguns at clay targets.
A lot of it was practicing with skeet shooting, you know, with a shotgun, and they would send one of those little clay things. And we did a lot. We ended up with big black and blue shoulders from all the recoil. So some of the guys later on, they would stuff some sweater or something in there to avoid that recoil. Then they would send us on little planes, and they would have a cool plane flying with a tool, and we would fire a jet.
Out of 400 students in his gunnery class, Sergeant Baca was rated among the top five. His superb marksmanship would prove to be a great asset to his crew later on in combat. After they had attended their various specialty schools all over the country, the crewmen assembled at Marchfield, California, where this picture was taken, in February of 1944. There they became acquainted with each other and began flying the B-24 bomber, learning to work together as a team. However, flying at Marchfield was a risky business. Many of the bombers used for training there were worn-out combat veterans that had been brought back from the war fronts.
Some of them were bombers that had come back from overseas, all battered and everything else. We used to dread getting on those things.
As a result, there were numerous crashes with the loss of entire crews. Mr. Baca remembers a day when 6 bunks suddenly became vacant in their barracks when another crew's bomber crashed and they were all killed.
We lost a crew, 10 men went down on the bomber and it just crashed, and all of them were, and 6 of those men were in my barracks, and I still remember the supply people coming in the next morning and picking up their clothing and their blankets, and we saw 6 empty cots there. That shook us up.
The cots occupied by the Horner crew nearly became empty as well when they took off one morning in a bomber that they discovered could only barely fly. The worn-out old airplane refused to climb. They ended up just skimming across the ground, dangerously low, unable to rise. What was rising, however, was the boulder-strewn desert terrain beneath them. It was rising up to meet them, and it looked like another disaster in the making.
We took off, got up about 100 feet, plane lost altitude, and couldn't figure out what was the matter. We kept adding power to the plane, and as you got away from the airport, the ground started rising, and it got closer and closer to the plane.
The ground came up as fast as we were trying to get up.
That plane could not get any lift.
And boulders about the size of houses were all over the place. And after 10 or 15 minutes, we hadn't gained any altitude, and every once in a while you'd fly over a boulder that was almost high enough to hit the bottom of the plane. And I frankly was looking for a place to crash it. But if I hit one of those boulders, we were sawdust.
It seemed like if we could have reached with our hand, we would have touched the boulders.
And so the bomber staggered full throttle across the desert floor while the pilots waited to see if it was going to sink down to disaster among the boulders or slowly climb to safety. Everyone in the crew realized that the next few minutes would decide whether they lived or died.
It was a terrible experience. Finally, we gradually gained enough altitude that we were able to make a real shallow circle. And we circled in the valley, shallow enough that we were gaining a few feet of altitude.
We were just hoping and praying that that plane could make it over the top of the mountain.
Eventually, we did get up through the valley there and got back to Mars Field.
Somehow we managed to get that warped, twisted old plane back to Mars Field. But it scared the heck out of all of us. We had a plane that should never have been flying.
The 9-week combat crew training at Mars Field was complete by early May of 1944, and the crew was told that they would soon be heading out to the Pacific War Theater to join one of the bomb groups of the U.S. 5th Air Force. Which bomb group would be determined after they arrived there? No one was unhappy to say farewell to Mars Field and its worn-out, dangerous old training bombers. At Fairfield-Suisun Army Airfield near San Francisco, they were issued a shiny, brand-new bomber straight out of the nearby Consolidated Aircraft plant at San Diego.
And we picked up a brand-new B-24. This is what we were to fly overseas.
They all had high hopes that this brand-new airplane, perfect in every respect, would take them through the war and then bring them safely home again. Lieutenant Horner told his crew that when they returned, they would celebrate by flying the bomber underneath the Golden Gate Bridge at San Francisco.
He says, when we come back, I'm going to fly this thing under the Bay Bridge. And of course, we all thought it was going to be that way, you know. How foolish we were.
In the pre-dawn darkness of May 19, 1944, the 10 young men of the Horner crew climbed aboard their bomber and stowed away their personal effects, ready to face an uncertain future and whatever fate had in store for them in the World War. They took off from Fairfield-Suisun Army Airfield near Sacramento, and as dawn broke, they headed out over the Golden Gate Bridge toward the frighteningly empty Pacific Ocean. Tom Theobald, their navigator, set the course for Hawaii.
I can remember going over the Golden Gate Bridge and thinking, well, this is your first big operation as a navigator. You really have a job cut out for you now to get them safely to Hawaii.
No one in the crew had ever flown over water before, so no one knew exactly what to expect.
The co-pilot was from California, so he had seen the ocean, but nobody had flown over the water before.
It would take 14 hours to reach Hawaii. As hour after hour went by, and nothing but water could be seen out to the horizon in all directions, at least one crewman began to fear that he might never see land again.
Dale, he got panicky, because hour after hour, nothing but water, and the poor guy, he kept looking, and of course there was no land to look at. And I could tell he was really getting stressed. And finally, Horner says, there's Hawaii up ahead. And oh, this guy, he was jumping up and down with, he was convinced that we were going to go down in the water, I guess.
They landed at Hickam Army Airfield next to Pearl Harbor, happy to have passed their first big test, and they noticed piles of wrecked American airplanes still lying on the field from the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor.
Here was a field where all the bombers and fighters that the Japs had destroyed were all piled up, and we all stood there just shocked.
We stayed there, if I recall, two nights, kind of getting our feet on the ground and getting the plane checked over. And then we took off south-southwest to Canton Island, which was basically a refueling stop. There wasn't much there other than maintenance hangars and gassing facilities.
Finding tiny Canton Island in the middle of watery nowhere would be entirely up to their navigator, Tom Theobald. Only a few degrees of error in their compass heading would cause them to miss it. And if they failed to find the island, with their fuel critically low, the result would likely be fatal. Other crews had missed Canton Island and were never seen again.
Island, probably about 2 miles long, relatively smaller than a needle in a haystack.
This was a real test of navigation. But there again, I was able to get them there okay.
You wouldn't believe it. When we flew over it, we just couldn't. A little spit of land, that's all it was. A little atoll. I remember one of the guys saying, man, have we got a good navigator that he could find this little spit of land out here. He was a fabulous navigator, boy, I'll tell you.
We landed there, spent the night. The next morning, we took off for the Fijis.
After an overnight stay in the Fiji Islands, the bomber was gassed up again, and the crew set off for New Caledonia, the final stepping stone to Australia. When they finally reached Garbutt Army Airfield at Townsville, Australia, they had flown over 7,600 miles from San Francisco, and their homes were now on the other side of the world. Now there was less than 700 miles to go to get into the hot part of the war zone at Port Moresby on the southern coast of New Guinea. But at Townsville, the crew experienced a major disappointment. They were told that they would not be able to keep the shiny new bomber that they had been issued at San Francisco.
And that's where we found out to our distress that that plane was not going to be our plane. We were just flying it over.
We had assumed that that was our airplane and we were going to take it overseas, going to keep it. And we started coming up with names. One of the names was the Fertile Turtle.
But the Fertile Turtle, or whatever name they would have settled on, was not to be theirs. They had hoped to fly this one B-24 throughout their combat tour and then bring it triumphantly home.
We get there to Townsville and say, oh no, you were just flying it over. When you go to New Guinea, you'll get planes up there, beat up planes too. We were just so disillusioned at that. But that's the way it was.
Reluctantly leaving their new bomber behind, they took an overhauled B-24 across the Coral Sea and landed at Jackson Airfield at Port Moresby on the southern coast of New Guinea. There they settled into temporary tent quarters, which they would occupy for the next several days while they became oriented and introduced to life near the equator in the tropics. And, like all other Americans in the Southwest Pacific, they found the living conditions considerably less than ideal. Americans before World War II knew little about conditions in the South Pacific. Pictures in National Geographic magazine or the Bob Hope Bing Crosby road movies, which featured the actress Dorothy L'Amour as a lovely native of the jungles, had many Americans believing that it was a paradise, a land where palm trees swayed gently in the trade breezes above beautiful sandy beaches. When American servicemen arrived in the area, all such illusions were quickly shattered by the harsh realities of life in the tropics. Behind the picture postcard scenery, the jungles on the Pacific Islands were hellholes of blistering heat and humidity. where incessant rains drenched landscapes as rugged as any on earth, creating endless tracts of mud and rotting vegetation. Metal rusted, clothing rotted away, and fungus attacked human skin. Swarms of mosquitoes and other insects carried malaria and numerous other tropical diseases, and the jungles were inhabited by Stone Age native tribes that practiced headhunting and cannibalism. 15-foot-long pythons and deadly cobras slithered into their tents, and bats as large as buzzards circulated under the jungle canopy. The many streams, rivers, and swamps were infested with crocodiles and blood-sucking leeches, the surrounding oceans were filled with sharks, and anyone who had hoped that the native women would look like Dorothy L'Amour were sadly disappointed. The women of the Pacific Islands were too far ahead of their time in the matter of tattoos, and they also didn't apply their makeup the same as Dorothy L'Amour. All of these hardships and disappointments could be borne by the young men of America's armed forces. But one thing that they could not shrug off was disease. When they got to Port Moresby, the members of the Horner crew, like nearly all other Americans in the Pacific, started coming down with tropical diseases.
Everybody immediately got, we call it the GIs, which was diarrhea. And of course, there again, we had no place to wash our hands or anything.
For every 2 men who were lost to combat, 5 men were lost to disease. Malaria was the most common malady, but the long list of diseases included cholera, beriberi, scrub typhus, dysentery, hepatitis, tropical ulcers, jungle rot,
blackwater fever, dengue fever, yellow jaundice. Of course, I had malaria all the time I was there, but you took Adderbrin and that kind of suppressed it. And oh my goodness, the doctors used to tell us, we're diseases here we never even knew existed.
And on top of the harsh realities of the Pacific environment, the jungles were filled with the Japanese invaders. Ruthless, fanatical, and suicidal fighters, they almost never surrendered and had to be dug out of their concealed positions in caves and bunkers and destroyed. It was hard, dangerous, brutal, dirty work, and many young American lives were lost in the process. But that was the job of the infantry. The men of the U.S. Army Air Corps had their own dangers to face, but at least their living conditions were somewhat better than the foot soldiers. The flyers, the aircraft mechanics, and other support personnel lived in tent encampments beside the airfields, and the airfields were typically some distance back from the fighting front. However, the American airfields were frequently bombed by the Japanese, despite the best efforts of the anti-aircraft guns that were set up around the airfields, and American fighter planes, which attempted to intercept the Japanese attackers and drive them away or shoot them down. And even in the tent towns, there was no escaping the 100-plus degree temperatures, the steaming humidity, the jungle diseases, the bad food, and rains that sometimes seemed to go on forever, so that everything had to be done in mud. The island of New Guinea, just north of the continent of Australia, is the second largest island in the world. Only Greenland is larger. The shape of the island has been compared to a turkey buzzard. The distance from the buzzard's beak to the tip of its tail is 1,500 miles, and its width at the widest point is about 400 miles. Lying just south of the equator, it's a land of startling contrasts. From the sea level elevation along the coast, the land rises to nearly 15,000 feet in the central mountains, which contain glaciers and are covered with snow. As pilots discovered in World War II, an airplane taking off in the stifling heat of the tropical lowlands can be in a snowstorm only a few minutes later over the mountains. The American advance from Australia towards the Philippines and Japan went up the back of the turkey buzzard, along the northern coastline of the island. Nearly all of the ground fighting between the Allied forces and the Japanese took place within a narrow strip along the northern coastline. Neither the Japanese nor the Allied forces ever penetrated very far into the interior of the island. The tropical rainforest, the jungle, was practically impenetrable, and the Owen Stanley mountain range was a formidable barrier. There were also many hostile native tribes in the interior, some of which had never seen a white man, and many of them were cannibals. And while the ground soldiers rarely saw the dangerous interior of the island, for the aviators it was a different matter. Airplanes roamed freely over all parts of the island, and if an airplane went down, it might go down anywhere.
When they used to tell us of safe areas to bail out, they said, don't bail out in this area, there's headhunters, or don't bail out in this area, there are cannibals.
But pilots and crewmen, in an emergency, sometimes had little choice where they would bail out or crash land. The prospect of being forced down into unexplored jungle among cannibals was the nightmare of every aviator on New Guinea in World War II. And yet, all too often, that nightmare came true. Lieutenant Hank Chovanec was the pilot of a crew that often flew a bomber that they nicknamed Check'em. They had arrived at Port Moresby about a year before the Horner crew, and they were flying their combat missions from there. On April 30, 1943, they took off on a lone reconnaissance flight to the Japanese stronghold of Wewak on the north coast of the island. This was what was called an armed reconnaissance. Their main job was to examine and get photographs of the Japanese airfields at Wewak, but they also had bombs to drop, and they were prepared to defend themselves against Japanese fighter planes. Since they were flying alone, no one knows exactly what happened. But their bomber crashed into the Owen Stanley Mountains about halfway back to Port Moresby. When they failed to return, another aircraft was sent out to search for them. The searchers spotted the wreckage of the B-24 and also saw signal flares rise up from near the wreckage. They returned to Port Moresby with the news that at least some of Lieutenant Chovanec's crew had survived the crash. A rescue party was quickly organized. They took off in a DC-3 and landed at a small airfield near the village of Bena Bena. For their protection, they took with them 10 native policemen who had been trained and armed by the Australians. The next day, May 10th, the party set off up the mountain. The farther they went, the more signs they saw that they were entering hostile cannibal country. At last, after 4 days of hard uphill trekking through the jungle, they reached the wreckage of Lieutenant Chovanec's bomber. There had been 12 men aboard the B-24. The bodies of 9 of them were found in the wreckage. Apparently, 3 men had survived the crash of the bomber, and it must have been they who had fired the signal flares at the search plane. Part of the airplane's tail appeared to have been used as a shelter. The question was, where were these men now? The bodies of the dead crewmen were gathered and buried beneath makeshift wooden crosses, and the burial service included a rifle salute by their armed native allies. While these activities were in progress, a horde of armed cannibals appeared on the hills above them with obviously hostile intentions. Members of the search party fired their guns in warning, and in the confusion that followed, 2 of the search party's native bodyguards dashed forward, seized a cannibal chieftain, and held him hostage. During the truce that followed, Australian Sergeant Jock Essen, speaking through interpreters that he had brought with him, questioned several of the tribesmen concerning the whereabouts of the missing Americans. If there had been any question that these were truly cannibals, it took only a glance at their ornaments, which were made of human body parts, such as this human jawbone necklace and earrings made of human fingers, to put all doubt to rest. Under close questioning, several of the cannibals finally admitted that there had been 3 survivors of the bomber crash, but they had been captured, killed, and eaten. During the interrogation, a great crowd of cannibals gathered and pressed in menacingly on all sides. Although these were primitive Stone Age warriors, armed only with spears, bows, and clubs, The members of the search party could see that they were outnumbered at least 10-1, and the outcome of any pitched battle might easily be themselves becoming the main course in the next cannibal feast. Since there was nothing more that they could do anyway, they decided that it would be prudent to withdraw. Back at Port Moresby, they reported the sad fate of Lieutenant Chovanec and his crew. The fact that three of the men had survived the crash of the bomber, only to be eaten by cannibals, was not made public. It was probably considered too horrible for the men's families to bear. The man who was placed in charge of Allied resistance to the Japanese was the American General Douglas MacArthur. He had been in charge of American forces in the Philippines, and when the American army there was overwhelmed, he escaped to Australia in a B-17 on orders of President Roosevelt. After he reached Australia, he issued his famous promise to the Filipinos, "I shall return." And from that point onward, he was obsessed with retaking the Philippines and then carrying the war to Japan itself. But MacArthur had a problem. He didn't have very much to work with. Shortly after America entered the war, Britain's Prime Minister Winston Churchill and American President Franklin Roosevelt had decided that the Allies should concentrate on defeating Germany first and only afterward deal with Japan. General MacArthur was told that he would only be allotted about 10% of America's war production, and that he should use it to engage Japan in a holding action until after Germany was defeated. But holding actions were not MacArthur's style, nor was it the style of the U.S. Navy under the leadership of Admiral Chester Nimitz. Despite his meager resources, MacArthur went on the offensive, devising a strategy that he called hitting 'em where they ain't, bypassing and isolating strong Japanese garrisons, cutting off their supplies, and, as he said, letting them wither on the vine. Following this strategy, he advanced northward up the northern coast of New Guinea, finding and seizing suitable locations to build air bases, because the heavy bombers of the 5th Air Force, the B-17s and B-24s, were his primary offensive weapons. MacArthur and Nimitz developed a two-pronged strategy. MacArthur and his army forces would advance along the north coast of New Guinea, building airfields as he went, so that American bombers could reach first the Philippines and then Japan itself. At the same time, Nimitz, with the Navy and Marines, would take a more direct route toward Japan, working their way up the smaller island chains. This was the campaign that resulted in the famous bloody island battles: Guadalcanal, Tarawa, Saipan, Iwo Jima, Okinawa, and others. And the strategy was the same: to capture islands to build airfields on, so that the bombers could reach ever further north until they finally could bomb Japan. Because air power, after all, was the deciding factor in World War II. MacArthur's strategy went into high gear in the spring of 1944, with a rapid series of amphibious landings on New Guinea's north coast. On the 22nd of April, the Americans took Hollandia and Idape. On the 17th of May, they landed at Maffin Bay. And on the 27th of May, the Americans assaulted Biak Island. Now things were moving fast. Each one of these landings was made by elements of the U.S. Army, supported by the Navy and the 5th Air Force. The Navy bombarded the shoreline before the landing craft went in, and the 5th Air Force's bombers and fighters provided air cover. After the shoreline had been pasted by the heavy guns of the U.S. Navy and by the bombs and guns of the U.S. Army Air Corps, the Japanese defenders were often either dead, too dazed to resist, or had retreated inland, so that American troops going ashore in many cases met with little to no resistance. Sometimes within a few hours, the American aircraft, the C-47s, the fighters, and the bombers would begin to land. After all these locations had been captured, General MacArthur had heavy bomber bases at Port Moresby, Nadsab, Wakhdi Island, and Biak Island. The Horner crew would see all of them. And once their combat missions began, they would be bombing across an area larger than the continental United States.
From Port Moresby, we went to Nadsab, and there we joined the 90th Bomb Group, which identified itself as the best damn heavy bomb group in the world.
The 90th Bomb Group was known as the Jolly Rogers. The name Jolly Rogers came about after Colonel Arthur H. Rogers assumed command of the 90th Bomb Group in July of 1943. Colonel Rogers was a charismatic and aggressive commander who personally led the 90th on many of its combat, and it was said that he prowled the sea lanes looking for ships to prey on like an old-time pirate. Someone remembered that the traditional pirate flag, the skull with crossed bones, was known as the Jolly Roger. And the 90th Bomb Group of the 5th Air Force, led by Colonel Rogers, soon became known as the Jolly Rogers. They adopted the pirate emblem, but they changed the crossed bones into crossed bombs. An artist in the group made a large aluminum stencil that they used to paint the symbol on the tails of all their bombers. This caught the attention of the press and the public, and was the beginning of the 90th Bomb Group's rise to fame. They would become the best-known heavy bomb group of the Pacific War. The large skull and cross-bomb symbol on their tails also made the 90th's bombers very easy to recognize in the air. From Nadsab, the Horner crew next moved to Wakhdi Island, a tiny island just off of New Guinea's north coast at Maffin Bay.
We moved up to a small island called Wakhdi, and it was right off the coast of New Guinea.
But Wakhdi Island was within range of Japanese bombers, and it was being bombed every day, mostly at night.
We got there, it was late in the afternoon, and right away they told us this place is under bombardment every night. And that night they told us, you use that tent, so the 10 of us, so our cots were right next to one another. Of course, we didn't take our clothes off because they said the bombing raids begin sometimes without warning. There was a discussion, should we take our shoes off? And all of us decided, no, we're going to sleep with our shoes. And Horner said, oh, I'm sure that when the alarm comes, we have time to put on our shoes. Well, that night when we woke up, the bombs were falling all over the place. And we all ran out, and I remember poor old Horner, my shoes, I can't find my shoes. And I still remember Ostov and the bombardier, that'll teach you silly ass to take off your shoes.
All I wanted to do was to get to that slit trench. But the first ones in are the ones that are hurt because
everybody falls on top of them.
But the island's airfield was so short and the bombers so heavily loaded that every takeoff was a dangerous adventure. During the year that this airfield was in heavy operation, numerous bombers failed to lift off the runway in time and crashed into the sea, killing their crews.
The airstrip took up the full length of the island.
The runway ran from one end to the other.
We had to get that plane off the ground. You had to horse it off the ground before you would like to, and every plane is different. Some planes would be 3, 4, 5 miles an hour difference. It can be 200 or 300 feet of runway.
We used to have an expression, we sweated it up, you know, because the runway was the length of the island. It was a small island, and these planes overloaded with gasoline and bombs. We knew we were coming to the end of the runway, and that plane was still not off the ground. And then just as we got to the end, you could feel, I think the wheels almost touched the water sometime. But oh, I tell you, it was a very worrisome thing.
On June 29th, 1944, the day before the Horner crew's first combat mission, a bomber piloted by Lieutenant Joseph Nessler failed to get off the runway and crashed into the ocean. It exploded and killed every man aboard. The crew's remains were so fragmentary and intermingled when they were recovered that today 8 of the men rest together in a single grave at the National Cemetery at Fort Scott in Kansas. The next day, June 30th, the Horner crew took off on their first combat strike against the Japanese. Their mission was to bomb a Japanese airfield at Babbo. All 9 of the B-24s assigned to the strike got off the runway without mishap. As they neared the target, anti-aircraft fire began coming up from the ground. It was a new experience and not a pleasant one.
It would be a black puff, you know, as anti-aircraft shells would explode. It was a black puff of smoke.
The black puffs were everywhere, all around them, along with the loud explosions. Later, they would come to largely ignore anti-aircraft fire as just another on-the-job hazard. But this first experience of it was terrifying for at least one crew member.
This other waste gunner, he was scared out of his wits. Yelled at him.
Caught the Japanese by surprise with their air. But the Japanese continued to hit back, although not as effectively. Japan had no 4-engine heavy bombers comparable to the American B-24. But at least one of their twin-engine deployed American anti-aircraft gunners and fighter planes in the dark. These not and the cover didn't always work.
We got bombed, and these 5 mechanics that were... Lo and behold, on that day, a bomb hit. My God, he said, we picked up little bones here, little pieces there.
The small island was jammed with American...
The island was packed. There were tents of... in a flash, and we were without gasoline for about 2 or 3 days till new supply.
The Horner crew endured the nightly bombings and continued to fly their mission. Black bursts of anti-aircraft shells. A direct hit by a shell could be fatal, as seen in this dramatic footage of a B-24 that was hit in the wing root. The wing folds, the fuel ignites, and the bomb. The B-24 Liberator could take a lot of flak damage and still get its crew home. But the long, thin, high-performance Davis wing often could not withstand a direct hit. But no matter where a B-24 was struck by flak, the worst situation was if a fire broke out. 10 fire suppression systems, or the crew, were unable to put out the fire, then it was necessary to get out. And get out fast, as a crewman can be seen doing in this photograph. Any man who took a few seconds too long to get his parachute on and get out risked going down in an inferno fed by hundreds of gallons of high-octane aviation gasoline as the airplane melted and fell apart. Much more common than a direct hit was for a bomber to be struck by the spray of shrapnel, described by one crewman as sounding like a handful of gravel thrown against a tin roof. Sergeant Baca was hit by a piece of metal one day while standing at his waste gun window.
As we were flying over the targets, we would stand by our guns ready in case any aircraft came at us. And of course, we'd be seeing the puffs of the anti-aircraft fire all around us all the time. And that one time that I got hit, I was very taken back. It was just a little cut on the forehead. I felt it when it hit me. I felt the sting. And I was very, very surprised.
That should have been reported. He should have got a Purple Heart for it. I didn't know anything about it.
I never told him or anybody else. I said, I just thank God that that little piece of shrapnel didn't do any more harm. You know, it could have gone through my brain.
Bullets from Japanese fighter planes were another deadly hazard, as witnessed one day by Lieutenant Theobald.
There was a B-24 that landed from some other group than ours, and I noticed they took somebody off head first in a stretcher, and come to find out it was the navigator, and the navigator had been killed. And what had happened was that he was standing between the pilot and the co-pilot, and he was hit in the head with a shell from a fighter plane. And so I was thinking, I am not going to be standing up between the pilot and the co-pilot.
On the 16th of August, 1944, after about 2 months on Wakhti, the Horner crew moved up to Biak Island. The 90th Bomb Group, the Jolly Rogers, would operate from Biak Island for the next 5 months. The battle to capture Biak Island was barely over when the Jolly Rogers arrived there. There were still hundreds of Japanese soldiers hiding out in caves near the airfields, and although the army established a perimeter to keep them out of the camp, some still managed to slip in at night to attack the Americans or to steal food and supplies.
And there were a number of instances of Japs slipping in, cutting the throats of guys on their cots, and also throwing hand grenades into the tents. We had to post guards ourselves, and then everybody put trip wires with tin cans with pebbles in there. And at night, you were afraid to leave your tent. Just, I'm so-and-so, don't shoot, because you could hear everybody clicking their guns, you know.
One of them at night came down and tried to get into the eating tent, and he was captured.
The Japanese soldier captured in the 90th Bomb Group camp area on Biak on November 12, 1944, was starving and dressed in rags. He was given food, clothing, and medical attention, interrogated, and then evacuated to a prisoner of war camp. But while he was in the 90th Bomb Group's camp, he was a great curiosity. Most Japanese soldiers preferred death to capture, and very few prisoners were ever seen.
Oh, he looked horrible. Most of us had never seen a Japanese.
I don't know what they did with him. We didn't shoot captives like the Japs did.
The Japanese tortured, murdered, or enslaved their captives, so Japanese who fell into American hands were surprised, refused to recognize the rights of prisoners of war as specified in the Geneva Convention. American airmen who bailed out over Japanese-held territory were well aware that if they were captured by the Japanese, they would likely be tortured and murdered, and many said that they would rather commit suicide than be captured.
We carried a .45 in our holster on our shoulder. The other guys all used to say, after we knew how badly they treated their prisoners, I'll take my .45 and kill myself. And I used to tell them, I can't do that. I says, that's against my religious beliefs. But I used to, in my mind, fantasize that if I landed in the Jap base, that I was going to empty my .45 into them and hopefully that they would kill me. But thank God we didn't have to ever do that.
A photograph of the Horner crew taken on Biak Island in the summer of 1944 shows a confident and competent group of young men with about 30 missions under their belts by this time. They were more than halfway through their combat tour, but they still had many dangerous missions ahead of them. By this time, Lieutenant Horner had made an interesting observation about his crew. We have 5 Catholics and 5 Protestants, he said, and I've noticed that whenever the going gets really tough, the 5 Catholics pray and the 5 Protestants cuss.
I don't believe it. They pray. I remember one fellow there, he was not noted for his religion. He said, man, he says, it's amazing how I can pray when things are really hot.
One of the times that things got really hot was on September 3, 1944, when the 90th Bomb Group participated in a raid on a Japanese airfield at Langawan in the Celebes Islands. It was a big raid by Pacific War standards. 60 B-24s from the 90th, 43rd, and 22nd Bomb Groups hit the target, wrecking the airfield and destroying many Japanese aircraft on the ground. But some Japanese fighter planes managed to get into the air and attacked the bombers. Flying just to the left of the bomber flown by the Horner crew, a B-24 piloted by Lieutenant Edward J. Mahaney was hit and dropped out of the formation with one engine smoking.
We saw it going down in smoke, and that was the first time we saw a bomber shot down.
Some members of Mahaney's crew managed to bail out as their bomber went down. Their parachutes were seen, but they were never heard from again.
We never heard of a single person that ever parachuted over a Jap base ever came home. We knew that they would torture you for information, and then they would end up by killing you.
As Lieutenant Mahaney's bomber was going down, one of the Japanese fighter planes turned and made a pass at Lieutenant Horner's bomber. But Sergeant Baca saw him coming and was ready at his waist gun. The skill that had put him at the top of his class in gunnery school would now be put to the test.
I remember those fighters came in, they shot Mahoney's crew. The other three or four, I don't know how many they were, they peeled off. But I saw one of them slip under our plane. And I said, I know that guy's coming after us. So right away, I was on my gun. And the minute he was within my range, or within my eyesight, I started firing at him. I saw a part of it blew off. And I heard the bombardier Ostafa say, "You got him, you got him." But then he continued. And later on, some of the gunners and the other crews finished him off, they said.
Baca got a shot at a plane that passed by outside his window behind the engines, grabbed his guns and locked the triggers down, and the plane flew right through the bullets.
Thanks to Sergeant Baca's marksmanship, one Japanese fighter plane would never menace another American bomber. The remaining fighters broke off their attack, and the American bomber formation returned to base without further losses. Back at Biak, the tents of the Mahaney crew stood empty. The fates of the crewmen who parachuted from the burning plane onto the Japanese-held island would never be known. No trace of them was ever found after the war, and all their families ever knew was that they were missing in action. If the Japanese fighter plane that shot them down had picked the bomber flying to the right of theirs instead, it would have been the Horner crew that was never heard from again. But such are the fortunes of war. When the American bombers moved forward from Wakdi Island to the airfield on Biak Island, the Philippines came within the range of the B-24s. General MacArthur could now start using the bombers to soften up the Japanese defenses in the Philippines for his invasion. But it was a long way to fly, and now the B-24s would be being used at their maximum range. To get to the Philippines, the bombers would have to cross over 900 miles of open water, and then, after dropping their bombs, would have to come all the way back again. These flights would take 14 hours and more. A grueling test of both man and machine. The bombers would have to take off in the middle of the night in order to get back to Biak in the afternoon and land in daylight. During those long hours of night flying, most crew members took the opportunity to catch up on their sleep.
On those 14-hour flights, we would take off at midnight from Biak. And the minute we got up to our proper altitude and the pilot reported everything was in order, next thing you know, everybody was sleeping. You just lay on the floor of the plane and maybe use your jacket or something for a pillow if you had one. It didn't take much for us guys to go to sleep.
Often, only Lieutenant Horner would remain awake, since someone had to fly the airplane.
But I'd crank my seat back, put my feet up on the instrument panel, and just watch the clouds. Now, when you're flying above the cumulus clouds, they're like a cotton field. You see miles and miles and miles of moonlit clouds. It's quiet, no turbulence, and I could sit there while nine other people were snoozing away, and I'd look out, I had the whole world to myself.
At the approach of dawn, Lieutenant Horner would call his crew over the intercom to wake them up and let them know it was time to go to work. At the rendezvous point, usually over some landmark such as an island, The other bombers, which had also flown alone through the night, located each other and began to assemble into formations.
By the time we got there, there may be another plane there, and pretty soon there'd be the whole squadron.
And as they started their bomb runs, sometimes the Japanese fighter planes would attack.
If they could get to you before you got to the target, they would attack. But of course, their object was to prevent you from bombing their targets. But then the minute you came over their target, they would all disperse because they didn't want to get caught in their own anti-aircraft fire. And then they would be waiting out there after you had gone to their anti-aircraft gun to pounce on you again. What our real defense strategy was, that as our bombers were flying, our aim was to throw a wall of fire all around us. Because every third or fourth bullet was a tracer. We could see them all. And the Japs saw it too, and they got unnerved. They were human.
Not all fighter plane attacks involved gunfire. The Japanese also developed an aerial phosphorus bomb. A Japanese fighter plane could release one of these bombs over a formation of American bombers and shower the bombers with lumps of burning phosphorus.
They had to come at you from the front when they used phosphorus. They come at you at 12 on their back, flit S, and when they kick the bomb out of the belly, and it would go out like a big lump, and then boom, and it, all these trails would go out. They could cover a whole squadron with a bomb.
To me, they looked like a spider, because they would spread out, and it was just like the legs of a spider.
It's a lump of white phosphorus, and it's smoking. And it hits your nacelle, or it hits any part of the plane that's got any configuration where it can lodge. And it just sits there and burns right through.
One plane, they got hit on their propeller, and it burned right through. We all went to look at that plane after it landed to see a big hole on the propeller, and those propellers were about that thick.
In the South Pacific, an even greater danger than the Japanese was the weather.
We lost two or three times as many people to weather or weather-related causes than the enemy.
Over there in the Pacific, weather was a big factor. There were not too many flights that we didn't fly through bad weather.
On one mission to the southern Philippines, they ran into a storm so large and so violent that it must have been a hurricane.
It was just breaking day, and we had just assembled and ran into a full typhoon. We had a full load of bombs, full load of gas, and we hit this wall. And it was black. We hit it after we had gotten together in formation. And all of a sudden, you're doing 5,000 feet a minute up and down, like an express elevator. You go, and something goes by you, either up or down, passing you, a big shadow. And somebody else that's out about 200 feet, well, that scares the hell out of you.
That plane was going up and down sideways. Water was pouring in through every side.
And the plane's filling up with water. Rainwater just comes in like a shower. And the water is running on the floor. Everybody's wet.
Well, there were so many openings in the plane that if you ever go into what I figured was almost solid water, there was no way to keep the water from coming in every direction. And finally, he called over the intercom and says, I can't control this plane anymore. He says, put on your parachutes. We're going to have to bail out. And boy, of course. So we put on our parachutes, and we were waiting for him to tell us the word to bail out. Finally, he managed to get the plane under control. And I guess somewhat later, we passed through this horrendous storm.
On the 900-mile return trips to Biak Island, from the bombing missions to the Philippines, which took about 7 hours, most of the crewmen had nothing much to do. The crew's co-pilot, Alan Cooper, had been a Disney artist before the war, and had worked on such Disney classics as Snow White and Fantasia. Sitting up in the cockpit on these long flights, he would take out pencil and paper and amuse himself and the crew by drawing cartoons, such as this co-pilot's view of the pilot on a busy day. And a sketch showing the pilot, Lieutenant Horner, leaning out the cockpit window to examine the result of their bombing, which has blown up a Japanese outhouse and seriously disturbed its occupant.
Just whistle while you work, and cheerfully together we can tidy up the place. So I'm a merry tune.
When he was on the ground, Lieutenant Cooper used his wonderful drawing talent to decorate the noses of some of the Jolly Rogers bombers. Someone with a rare roll of color film captured this example of his nose art in full color. The Boise Bronc was a B-24 often flown by a squadron leader who hailed from a horse ranch near Boise, Idaho. A pencil portrait that Lieutenant Cooper did of the pilot, James Horner, shows that he also excelled at serious art. Further testimony to the fabulous artistic talent of Alan Cooper.
Yankee brother, this is your Japanese sister, the voice of truth. You are making this futile sacrifice because of what your superiors are making you do.
Yeah, we used to listen to her all the time. The best music we had came from Tokyo Rose. We would go to the radio tent, and that's where we would listen to the news and then listen to Tokyo Rose. Tokyo Rose said, well, unfortunately, all of you are destined to be killed here. You'll never see your home again.
I am filled with sadness for you. Think it over, Yankee brother. This is the voice of truth. I will be with you again tomorrow. Those of you who are left to listen.
But her music, we always liked it because she played some of the most popular American music of the time.
Kiss me once, then kiss me twice, then kiss me once again. It's been a long, long time.
Entertainment celebrities from back home occasionally visited the Jolly Rogers as part of traveling USO shows. The glamorous movie star Carol Landis gave men the thrill of having their photographs taken with their arms around her. Comedian Joe E. Brown had fun trying to imitate the Jolly Rogers skull and bomb symbol. Gary Cooper was another of the movie stars who came out to visit. And radio comedian Jack Benny tried out the cockpit of a Jolly Rogers bomber that was named for him and had his picture painted on the side. The movie stars painted messages and wrote their signatures on bombs that would soon be dropped on the Japanese. John Wayne autographed the plaster casts of wounded men. And Bob Hope's traveling troupe also visited the sick and wounded in the hospitals. Hope entertained the Jolly Rogers on Biak Island on August 25, 1944. Mr. Baca remembers it well.
From somewhere in the South Pacific, we present the Bob Hope Show. Thank you. How do you do, ladies and gentlemen? This is Bob Mosquito Network Hope. Well, here we are in this beautiful, romantic South Pacific island. Wait till I see that Dorothy Lamour. What a lie.
There was guys up on trees and everywhere, and suddenly I remember one tree, I guess it must have been about five guys on one branch, and it came crashing down. Thank God nobody was hurt.
After the performance, the Jolly Rogers presented Bob Hope with a captured Japanese flag, which he said would make a fine rag to blow his nose on. When a B-24 dropped its bombs, they fell to either side of a narrow catwalk that joined the front and rear compartments of the plane. On one of the Horner crew's missions, a 500-pound bomb failed to drop.
Once in a while, a bomb will hang up, as it did in ours one time.
There were two shackles that would hold him, and apparently one of them released, but the back one didn't.
And the bomb dangles, which leaves you with a live bomb in the bomb bay, bouncing back and forth, and that's not a good feeling.
Someone would have to climb down onto that narrow catwalk and somehow pry the bomb free. As the crew's armorer, the job fell to Sergeant Baca. Lieutenant Ostefin, the bombardier, came back from his position in the nose to try to help. Together, they stood on the catwalk in a roaring wind, trying to pry the bomb loose. It was impossible to wear parachutes in such a confined space, so if either man slipped off the catwalk, he would fall thousands of feet to his death.
So if we tripped or something, it was a very touchy thing. When we went in there, we didn't know if that thing would explode on us. And I had my little tool bag with a screwdriver, and we were there clinging with one hand and trying to release the thing with a screwdriver with the other hand.
Our armorer gunner, waist gunner, Jamie Baca, went into the bomb bay with a screwdriver and hanging on to the bomb racks. He was able to free the bomb shackle and let the bomb go.
Finally, thank God we released it.
The bomb finally fell free and the crew was safe. For a bomber crew, it was all in a day's work.
That's what the armor does.
On another memorable mission, the Jolly Rogers caught a Japanese cruiser in the open sea and tried to bomb it. But they had to fly high, above 9,000 feet, because of the ship's heavy and accurate anti-aircraft fire.
Boy, the anti-aircraft fire that those people could put up was incredible.
The anti-aircraft from it was extremely accurate.
We were just hoping we could make it.
In the 30 seconds or so that it took for the bombs to fall from the bombers to the sea, the ship had enough time to maneuver out of the way, and none of the bombs hit it.
The odds of you doing any damage at all on the cruiser were very remote.
At the end, it turned out that after all our efforts, all we had done was inflict some damage.
We didn't spend much time there, and I don't think that we were very successful.
The Japanese cruiser escaped the bombs of the Jolly Rogers, but then 5th Air Force commanders sent in twin-engine medium bombers, which flew daringly just above the ship to skip bombs into its side. To do this, they had to fly straight into the teeth of the ship's ferocious anti-aircraft fire, and some of them were shot down. But the ship was sunk. On October 20th, 1944, a few hours after his troops landed, General MacArthur waded ashore on the Philippine island of Leyte. He had kept his promise. He had returned to the Philippines. The Jolly Rogers also moved up to the Philippines from Biak Island. On the 8th of February, 1945, the Horner crew flew a B-24 from Biak up to San Jose Airfield on the Philippine island of Mindoro. Within a short while, everyone on the crew had accumulated enough combat hours and missions to be eligible to return to the States. Their combat tour was over, and they had survived. Each man was issued orders authorizing him to return to the States by whatever means of transportation was available. Some caught rides on troop ships, others found space on aircraft returning to the U.S. By May of 1945, 1 year after they had flown out to the Pacific War Theater, every member of the Horner crew was back in the States. Behind them, the war still had 3 months to go. The two prongs of the American advance were closing in on Japan. The Emperor became increasingly desperate. First, he ordered his pilots to become suicide bombers. kamikazes sank ships and killed sailors, but the Americans kept coming. Next, the emperor followed the example of the cowardly monster on the other side of the world, Adolf Hitler, who hid behind children soldiers as the Allies closed in on him. To defend the emperor, even little Japanese girls were being taught to handle weapons. Every Japanese woman would be issued a bamboo spear and trained to use it against the invading Americans. The despicable emperor, who considered himself a divine being, expected that every man, woman, and child in Japan should die in battle to preserve his supposed honor. The American invasion of Japan was going to be a bloodbath of epic proportions. But the Americans had invented a new weapon, the atomic bomb, and they decided to use it to try to end the war. 8 million leaflets were printed up and dropped over Japanese cities whose war industries made them likely targets. The leaflets warned all civilians to leave the cities since they might become the targets of a bomb of unprecedented size. Apparently, not many Japanese took the leaflets seriously. On August 6, 1945, an atomic bomb was dropped on the city of Hiroshima. About 70,000 people were killed instantly, and later about the same number died from burns or radiation poisoning. President Truman called for surrender. Emperor Hirohito remained silent. 3 days later, a second atomic bomb was dropped on the city of Nagasaki. The death toll there was approximately the same. This second demonstration of overwhelming destructive power finally brought Hirohito to his senses. On August 15, 1945, the emperor announced the unconditional surrender of Japan. The Pacific War was finally over. The final death toll from the two atomic bombs would be approximately 200,000 people. But by ending the war and making the invasion of Japan unnecessary, the atomic bombs actually ended up saving millions of lives on both sides. World War II ended over 70 years ago. Very few people today remember the Jolly Rogers, the 90th Bomb Group, or the 5th Air Force in the Pacific, of which it was a part. In fact, some historians are now calling the 5th Air Force the Forgotten 5th. What we should never forget, however, are the men who went to war for America during World War II. So many of them were heart-achingly young. And sadly, a great number of them did not survive. Why some men lived, while others who were doing the same things died, is a question that can never be answered. These three 5th Air Force pilots were decorated for bravery in New Guinea in December of 1943. Only one of them would come home. When a heavy bomber went down into the ocean or the jungle, usually 10 men died. The Jolly Rogers never had more than a few dozen bombers at any given time, but they had 820 men killed during the war. Enough men to crew 80 bombers. And the 90th Bomb Group was only one of several groups that made up the 5th Air Force. All experienced similar losses. Many of the planes and their crews simply vanished into the endless expanses of the Pacific Ocean. The men's families received the dreaded missing in action telegram, and that is all the information that many parents and other relatives ever had for the rest of their lives. hundreds of other aircraft disappeared into the vast jungles of New Guinea and other Pacific islands. These are still being found, and will be for many years to come.
I maintain that for several centuries, they'll be discovering the wreckage of planes.
Each wreck found solves an old mystery. And in many cases, a crew finally gets to come home. Physically, anyway. For they all came home in spirit a long time ago. The graves of thousands of Americans remain in the cemeteries of the Pacific. Over 110,000 American servicemen lost their lives fighting the Japanese in the Pacific War. In a World War II cemetery, most of the gravestones represent a young man whose life was cut short. He never got to meet the girl of his dreams, and the family that he would have had with her died with him. So his gravestone marks not only a life lost, but lives never lived. World War II called the young men of America to arms. They accepted the challenge, and they were equal to the task. They defeated and eliminated two of the greatest evils that the world has ever known. The three surviving members of this bomber crew, James Horner, Jaime Baca, and Tom Theobald, was like to fly and fight in the big bombers. For that, and especially for what they did in the war, they have earned our most sincere gratitude, and we should never forget them. For a country that forgets its past and its heroes has no full stanza of our national anthem pretty much sum it up.